So welcome to the Digital Office Hour. This time it's about an extended Vasi Checkpoint pricing model. It's an extension I came up with in order to provide you with some additional exercises. And this exercise is now really connecting several concepts that we've talked about. It connects Gesanov, SDF, payment card, and change of measure. So basically, we assume that we want to price bond in an arbitrage-free way. We will set up our model. Yeah, so it's for our students, it's the first time we build our own model here. And the thinking will be we want to have the bond yields are driven by the risk-free rate and expectation of what the risk-free rate is doing in the future. But it should also be driven by market price of risk. Okay. Because we kind of know from PCA analysis that we need at least two factors, two independent factors, to explain roughly 95% of variation in bond yields. And therefore, we now set up the model such that we are saying one factor is the current short rate to the risk-free rate, and another factor shall be the market price for that short rate risk. Okay, and now we bring everything together, Feynman-Karch, SDF, Gesanov, and some Itô calculus. Now, I take several shortcuts, otherwise we spend hours on this tutorial, which we don't want to do. So therefore, I recommend you look at the Digital Office Hour on Feynman-Karch and VasiCheck. I had like three videos, and I refer to some of the shortcuts that I'm doing there because the structure will be a VasiCheck structure, but we just have a general market price of risk. Yeah? But some of the math, it just carries over. So therefore, let's just really think about what we want to do. Yeah, so it's really kind of research-based Digital Office Hour. So what are we doing as researchers? We wanna model the bond market. So what we have in mind is a specific setup that we then want to translate into math and then into the pricing equations. The setup shall be that in our economy, we have the following thing. We have a stochastic discount factor, and that stochastic discount factor, it tells us something about risk-free rate, so we want to need to specify the risk-free rate, and then we need to specify our market prices of risk and our systematic sources of risk. Yeah, so let's say that's my SDF shock. That's under P. I don't have to write that, but I just do it. And what we want to do in the model is that we want to assume that the systematic shocks in the economy, these are the shocks that pay a risk premium, that shall be two-dimensional. And we want that interest rate shocks are systematic. They will pay a risk premium. But I also, and that's the new part, I also want that the shocks to the market price of risk, they are also systematic. Okay. Now that has implications for the market price of risk. Now the market price of risk is also two-dimensional. And I want that to be, first of all, I want to have a market price of risk for the interest rate shock. Okay. I call it the extended VasiCheck because I want to treat that as a random variable itself. It should not be affine in R, what's assumed the VasiCheck, but it shall be a process in itself, a factor in itself. And I also want that under P and under Q, the dynamics of that process can differ. I therefore need to assume that the market prices of risk for shocks to the market price of risk is just an affine function in the market price of risk. Now, that is weird, but it's a good setup. Just need to get used to it, basically. That's a good exercise. Now, what do we do here? We have, what are the state variables? Yeah, let's give them a different color. State variables, let's make them yellow. That is a state variable and the lambda t's. But the lambda t depends only on lambda tr, and here it also depends on lambda tr. So we have two states, basically. Yeah. Our states, yeah, if we were to say states are, let's say, xt, 2t, 2 times 1. The short rate would be our state. And the market price of interest rate risk is our second state. That's the model we want to use, and we want to derive the bond price for such a model. Okay, now what do we need? We need additional assumptions. So we're still in the setup part. Okay, we need assumption for how does the short rate move? Extended Vasi check, so we want the short rate to be Gaussian. I use the same notation I've been using for the for the Vasi check tutorial. Okay. Now that chalk is systematic. You know by Gersanov theorem that I can rewrite that as dw r, q minus the market price of risk for the interest rate. Okay, right? If you do that, you know that drt, yeah, I want to highlight, that is under p, and now we are going to write that under q. I just make this measure transformation, so we have kappa p theta p minus rt. Now I have minus sigma r lambda rt dt plus sigma r dw r, qt. Okay. Now that's the state variable here. So we need another assumption of what is the dynamic of the state variable in the data of the market price of risk state variable. So we are saying that we are assuming, right? We are the researchers here, so we can make our own assumptions and then validate them by estimating the model. So we are assuming that the lambda follows a Gauss process. Yeah, we just copy that structure from Vasicek, so maybe I give that little r's here. Okay, so we would say that this is kappa p lambda. Oh, I see, I just remember in Vasicek I didn't call that theta, I called it r upper bar. Okay, I wanted to use the same notation, so that's what I should call it. Right, same thing here, it's a lambda upper bar minus lambda t. I should even give it a little r index. It's the market price of risk for the interest rate. Dt, yeah, that's the AR1 part. Mean reversion, speed of mean reversion, that's the long run mean of that process. And then there's a Gaussian shock. Okay. Now in my economy, I assume that shocks to lambda themselves are systematic with a linear risk premium or a linear market price of risk. So again, I can, by Gersanov theorem, I know I can just rewrite that as dw lambda, qt minus, and now the market price of risk for that shock, which we assume to be linear in the lambda. Yeah, so it's lambda zero. Check the notation. Yeah, it's with the lambda index. That's good. Plus lambda 1 lambda times lambda rt dt. Okay. So what you do is just you multiply that by the sigma lambda. You bring that here like I've done with Vasicek, and then you can see, you see that you can redefine these coefficients to be q coefficients. Because the constant part under p gets something on top, which is the lambda zero times that. Therefore, we define that then to be the q parameters. And the speed of mean reversion itself, it's the affine loading. It gets that affine loading times sigma r. Yeah. So go back to the Vasicek. I take some shortcuts, as I've said. But you can verify, I can just redefine that. That will be under q, that d lambda rt is just some mean reversion coefficient, but it's different from here if lambda 1 is different from 0. Verify that as an exercise. That should be obvious once you really do the multiplication. So please do it. And then here we have the long run mean of lambda r, which can be different. It will be different. It will be different. I apologize. It will be different if the lambda 0 here is different from 0. Okay. Okay. Okay, so what are the important... Okay, one more assumption. To make life simple and also have the PCA thought in mind, these are independent factors which are uncorrelated, at least. I want to make life simple, so I want to assume that the quadratic variation between lambda shocks and interest rate shocks is zero. Yeah, so maybe let's write it like that, or we don't need the expectation, it's already part of this notation here. So that shall be zero. Okay. Let's highlight the important equation and do some strong colors here. Again, what are we going to do? We are going to price a bond that will be done under Q, so we will need that dynamic. Because under Q we have risk premium adjustments, market price of risk adjustments, and we need the dynamic of lambda t under Q, which we've done here. Okay, that's also an ETO. Then we say that both shocks are uncorrelated with each other. Okay. So what we're now going to do is we are now going to price a bond, the entire term structure of bonds. Let's take Brown. Didn't have Brown today. So what's the goal? The goal is we want to find the price of a bond. So we want to find the price at time t of a bond that matures in tau periods from now. Yeah, that shall be defined. It is, what do we get in t plus tau? We get 1 euro, and it is discounted by the risk-free rate, and we can do so if we use the risk-neutral measure. Yeah, something we've talked about in prior classes slash videos, and now this is s of time t, the expectation. Okay, now we want to define that, going back to this Feynman-Kutch theorem, as being a function u, which depends on t. It depends on my state variables. The state variable will be r, but also the market price of risk. And then we have a maturity, or here time to maturity, I call it tau. Now, instead of capital T in Feynman-Kutch, I call it tau. It's just a transformation of the t, because the tau is just t minus t. Okay, so what do we know from Feynman-Kutch? Well, we know from Feynman-Kutch that we can solve that conditional expectation by solving the partial differential equation that u has to fulfill. So let's take some shortcuts. Like in Vasicek, I take a guess, and my guess is that the u has an exponential shape. I'm guessing it has that shape. Okay, and now we use the guess and verify method to verify that the guess is correct, and by doing so we will be able to determine these coefficients. Okay, what do we also know? We know from Feynman-Kutch, again, I've said I take several shortcuts here. Yeah. Now, we know from Feynman-Kutch that at maturity the bond is worth a euro. So that is one if AQ of 0 equals BQ of 0 equals BQ 0, if that is 0. If tau is 0, that all these coefficients need to be 0. So we have initial value conditions. And what I also know from Feynman-Kutch is that r t times u, yeah, that's this Feynman-Kutch PDE, needs to be equal to the generator needs to be equal to the generator of U plus the change in U with regard to T. Okay. Now, what was the generator? The generator was just the first derivative. Maybe we can write it like that. We have two states, so we take the first derivative with regard to state I. Then we multiply that. I take a Q here to highlight, it's under Q. We take the conditional drift of process I. And we add that up since we have two states. State is equal to 1 and 2. Okay. We have two states. The risk-free rate and the market price of risk, the lambda. Then we have the covariance part. I assume that these two states are uncorrelated with each other. Yeah, but in general, we know what we have to do. We are adding up over ij. They are both element of 1, 2 because I have two states. We would take the conditional variance or the conditional covariance matrix. We take the ij element and we then multiply that by the second derivative of the u function with regard to xi and with regard to xj. Okay, and then the last thing here is the first derivative with regard to time. Okay. I take several shortcuts. We should really understand the Vasicek problem that we have in the other video. Now we just borrow from that structure. So what we know is I just copy paste the left part. Okay, the right part. Okay, now what's the first derivative with regard to every state? We've done it in Vasicek. It's the same affine function here. We're just adding up these two things. So the structure is very much the same. It's the u. And now it gets multiplied, first derivative with regard to the state. The inner derivative is just the loading. So here it will be bqr of tau. And now I need to multiply by the expected change in the short rate under q. Yeah, having the risk premium adjustment or the market price of risk adjustment in. So that in Vasicek, in the Gauss dynamic, it looks... Okay, I change the notation here. It looks like that. But now I also have my market price of risk adjustment where that is its own state variable. Okay, that's good. Now I'm doing that for the second state variable. It has the same structure, so therefore I can just copy the structure, but the drift is different, of course. The drift under Q, we've done that above, so I can just remember what that was. We had mean of speed mean reversion under Q. We had the lambda r under Q, long run mean, minus lambda rt. Okay, so we are done. Now we need a variance. It's the covariance matrix, ijth element. But I assume that the off-diagonal elements are zero because I assume that these shocks to the short rate and the shock to lambda are orthogonal to each other. Okay. Which simplifies life. So I just have here 1/2. I have the variance of each state. It's just the Gauss variable, so therefore the variance is just, we go with r first, it's sigma r square. And now I need to take the second derivative of the function, the exponentially affine function with regard to the states. I just need to take the diagonal elements because of the zero covariance matrix, zero correlation between both shocks. And therefore, second derivative of that function with regard to each state is just the u times the loading to the power of 2. Okay, I can copy the structure for my lambda because the lambda is also Gauss, and in the Gauss it goes additively into the exponents. So therefore I also have here bq lambda tau square. Okay, and now I need this last derivative over t. In the Vasicek tutorial we spent some minutes on that. Now I just retake the shortcut because I remember that quite well. So we therefore have minus du, and then we multiply that by the change of the loadings with regard to time. They are added, the minus is here. Okay, if that trick is unclear, how I come from the change to t to the change of tau, check the Vasicek tutorial. I think it's video 2. It's the last video where we do that. Okay. Okay, that's the PDE. Good thing, we can cancel out that part. Now we have to match coefficients in order to verify that the guess is correct. Yeah. So what are the coefficients? The coefficients on RT on the left hand side, maybe let's just do the left hand side. That's for instructive purpose. On the left hand side, the RT has a loading of 1. The lambda t has a loading of 0, and the constant has a loading of 0. Right? And now we are matching that with the right hand side. So we will do that, and we start with the RT. We will start with the RT. Okay, RT on the left is 1. What's RT on the right hand side? Well, it is like in Vasicek, it's very much the same in the standard Vasicek. We have bq r tau times minus kappa. Huh? So we have minus here, and then we have a kappa pr here. Okay, now, wait a minute, something is missing. Ah, you see, well, I was too fast. The second derivative, if I take the derivative with regard to time, I take that with regard to time. I was so much distracted to talk about the tau versus the t that I haven't thought about it. If you take the derivative here with regard to tau, then these are constants. So they come down, which means we have RT here, and here we multiply it by lambda t. Okay. Okay. So therefore, matching the coefficients, we see there's something coming in here. It's a minus dbqr tau divided by d tau. Okay. Subject to BQR0 equals 0. Because of here. Okay. So that's a linear ODE. You can solve that right away. Yeah. So let me just, in order to take some shortcuts, BQR of tau will be, and you have the solution. Yeah, that's a good exercise for you. But it's like in the Vasicek, it's a linear ODE, take the integrating factor, integrate both sides, you get the solution. Okay, let's check. What about the lambda t? The lambda t on the left-hand side, there is no lambda, therefore the loading is zero. But on the right-hand side, I have lambdas. I have here the lambda. It is minus sigma r times bqr of tau. That's important because the point is BR tau is non-zero, and therefore the loading on lambda will also be non-zero. Okay, so we are here, and now we are here, so that's a minus, so we have then minus kappa q lambda times bq lambda of tau. That's this part. These are constants, constant, and then we have this part, it's also a minus. Then we have minus dB q lambda tau d tau. Okay. Subject to, we also know the starting value for that ODE is zero. Yeah, I do one more step, the rest you do yourself. I want to highlight that this is a linear ODE. We've seen that in class, that we can integrate that in a straightforward way. dBq lambda tau divided by d tau. I bring this to the other side. Plus kappa q lambda bq lambda tau equals minus sigma r bq r tau. Okay. Integrating factor. It's a linear ODE. That depends only on time to maturity, right? It's the solution from here. That's a function of tau, therefore it's a function of tau. So you just integrate that with regard to tau and that with regard to, yeah? So you take the integrating factor. It's e to the kappa q lambda times tau. Multiply the left and the right by the integrating factor. That's one more thing I'm doing explicitly. So here we have kappa q lambda tau, bq lambda tau. And then we have the integrating factor times tau minus sigma r bq r tau. Okay. I bring tau to the other side. We integrate both of these sides. Yeah. So we have bq lambda tau equals e to the minus lambda tau. I bring already this to the other side. The lower bound is zero because that at zero is zero. And now you just have to integrate that thing here. So you have sigma r as a constant. You have a minus here, which I bring up here. And now you just integrate, let's write it properly, from zero to tau. And you have e to the kappa q lambda times u. And now you multiply that by bq r of u, and you integrate that over u. That is known from your first step, yeah, that you complete yourself. And then that is a straightforward integration. There's no issue with that, so that gets a check. Yeah, you also solved for that second loading. And now we need just to get the constant, the AQ. So we want to match coefficients for the constant. The constant here is zero. So therefore we have zero needs to be equal to. Now what are the constants here? There are quite some constants. It's this one here, like invasi, check. Okay, so we have just bqr tau times the constant in the drift of r under q, but in our notation it is kappa p r upper bar p. The next constant is here, just again a mirror image. So it will be plus bq lambda tau times the expected constant part in the drift under q. Okay, it's this one. And then we have constant parts from the variance. That is okay, squared, half the variance. Yeah, so we have plus half bqr tau square, sigma r square, for the lambda sigma lambda square. Okay, that's these parts. And then this, these are also not, that is not dependent on the states. These are, they did, that's not, it's a minus. So therefore we have here minus dAq tau tau. Okay, now that is subject to the initial value condition is that. Right? So I do one more step for you. The rest you do yourself. You bring that to the other side, then you have a description. Okay, I do two things. That needs to be equal to whatever you have here. Getting a little bit, okay, so let's do that. It is kappa p r p b q r tau plus kappa q, there is a lambda missing here, lambda, lambda r b q lambda tau plus half square, 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 and square. Okay. That is what we already solved for above. That's what we solved for above. You then just square these things by binomial formula. So you get that. That looks a bit cumbersome, but still it looks okay. And then you integrate that. Yeah, so you know that your solution AQ tau is just your starting value, which is zero. And then you are just integrating this vector field, which is given here with regard to time from zero to tau. Right? Plug everything in, some deterministic integration, and that's how you found AQ tau. Yeah. So what we basically now did is we've solved for the bond price PT tau, which is indeed such a exponentially affine function in the two state variables, the short rate itself and the market price of risk for the interest rate risk. Okay, right? Therefore, when you just think about what's the bond yield YT tau continuously compounded is defined minus the log, you take the bond price, divide by the tau. So you have basically minus AQ tau over tau minus BQR tau over tau RT minus BQ lambda tau divided by tau times lambda RT. Yeah, so we now derived a two-factor model for government bond yields, default-free bond yields. They depend on these two factors that are independent of each other. One captures the path of future central bank policies because it's the short rate. The expectation is part of this loading here. And the other factor accounts for risk premium, yeah, for the market price of risk, because the realized path of short rates will differ from what we expect that to be. So I like that framework here. Most likely we have a problem set next week where we are estimating that model. Yeah, and once we talk about the Kalman filtering in class, we just filter out the market price of risk and the short rate. So that will be fun.